So now we're going to talk about something called a reaction quotient. It's very, very similar to an equilibrium constant, but it's abbreviated with a Q instead. And it's where the reaction is right now. K, the equilibrium constant, is where it wants to be, okay? So it's going to shift, it's going to either produce products or reactants, it's going to go one way or the other until finally it gets to equilibrium and it gets to K. So K is the target. Q is where it is right now. So we know how to calculate an equilibrium constant expression and write that expression out. Well, the Q has the exact same expression. So we're going to be filling some stuff in over here in a little bit, and it'll show up in your notes. But right now, we're looking at this reaction, okay, and we're going to be writing our expressions for that reaction. So what would K look like, which we had learned earlier, and let's do it in terms of concentration. It would be B's concentration over A's concentration. But we would put the values of these concentrations in at equilibrium. So I have an EQ after those to remind me that those are equilibrium concentrations that I put in. The reaction quotient, okay, it's a quotient, right? That's what this is a quotient. The reaction quotient would also look exactly like that. But instead of saying I'm putting equilibrium amounts in, what I'm going to put in is where I am right now. So I'll put a zero for initially, this is where I am. But it could be at any point along the way. It is where we are right now. So this is a snapshot, value-wise, of where the reaction is. This is its destination, where it wants to be. So we can take this little snapshot value of my reaction, compare it to this, and be able to predict which way the reaction will proceed. Now, I want you to think through this. I want you to stop the video and think about what will happen to the numerator and the denominator. So we've got a scenario here where Q is too big. It is not happy until it gets to K and Q is too big. So I want you to pick which one of those would be how you get from where it is to where it wants to be. All right, so hopefully you picked the numerator is too small, the denominator is too big. If this is bigger than where it wants to be, this is too big. Let's just focus on the numerator. That's going to make it bigger than it needs to be. It needs to get smaller. It's got to come into that K value. Well, what sits up here? That's products. It's too big. We got to get rid of some of that. So we're going to shift and make some reactants. So the numerator is too big. The denominator is too small. If it shifts the reaction this way, making more reactants, it's going to bring down the top number, bring up the bottom number, and get it back in line where it needs to be. So we can compare the value of Q to the value of K, and we're going to know which way the reaction needs to proceed in order to get to equilibrium. In this case, it's got to proceed and make more reactants. All right, so if Q is too small, the equilibrium is going to shift towards this direction, okay? If it happens to be that they're equal, hey, it's at equilibrium, and we're good, okay? It's not going to shift one way or the other. The forward and the reverse reaction are happening at the same rate. But if it's too small, it's got to get bigger. How does it get bigger? Well, it shifts to form more products, and it goes from left to right, forming more products. Now, so students who love to memorize things can memorize these statements and they can keep them straight by exam time and do just fine. I don't want you just to memorize the statements. I want you to think through this exercise. If it's too big, it's got to get smaller. How does it do that? If it's too small, it's got to get bigger. How does that do that? It will help you not just memorize it, but always know the answer. Because when you memorize something, you've got it for a short time and then it's gone, and you've got to memorize it again when the final exam rolls around, or when you start taking organic chemistry, or you take a biochemistry class down the road. But if you remember why it is the way it is, you're always going to be able to remember these shifts. Now, this is kind of a summary of what we just talked about and the shifting that we will see. So I've got this reaction, okay, and I'm telling you what the K value is, and I don't know if you can read that very well, but the K value is 2, okay? Now, let's say that we start this reaction where I have all A, and the concentration of A is 1, and there's no B, okay? What would Q look like? Well, we know that Q is B over A. So we would start right here at the first, right? We would have a Q value of 0. And obviously, if you have all A and no B, it's going to have to go this way. So it's going to be going towards products. So when Q is too small, it's going to go towards products. Let's say that this is the midpoint where A is 0.5 and B is 0.5. This would be a Q of 1. It's still not big enough, and it still would have to shift to the right. So here is the value of Q. Here it's here, and then it's here, and then it's here, and then it goes up to the point where if A is 0 and B is 1, what's the value of my Q? 1 over 0. So that goes all the way up to infinity, all right? But there's some point where it's actually equal, and that's going to be in this scenario when this is 0.67 and this is 0.33 because products, is that right? Do I have that written in the right direction? No, I don't. I was just kind of putting my way through that, and I'm like, that can't work. All right, A has dropped down to 0.33. We're closer to nothing. And B is climbing to two-thirds of the way there, 0.67. That's going to give me a Kc of the two. So at some point, the Q equals the Kc, and you're at equilibrium. When you're over here, it's going to be proceeding towards products, trying to make more products to get to equilibrium. If it's over here, it's going to be proceeding towards reactants to try to get to equilibrium. And if it's right there, by golly, we're at equilibrium. So that's what Q will tell you. And I told you that this is the beginning of equilibrium concepts. In every chapter along the way, as we're dealing with equilibrium, we'll have a discussion about comparing Q to K and deciding what will happen with the reaction. And so this principle will show up over and over again for us. Okay, so here we have a problem. We have a reaction given to me, so I might as well write the K expression and the Q expression, which they look the same, but one's with equilibrium. K would be SO3 squared over SO2 squared times O2, right? Q would look exactly the same. I'm going to put Q's. It's going to be all of the same thing. So why don't I, instead of writing it, change that to a Q? And know that I'm where I am now. Those are zeros. Where am I right now? And that's what they gave me. The following concentrations are present. And they want to know whether or not this reaction is going to proceed to the right to form more products or to the left to form more reactants. We know we have a value of Kc given to us. It is 4.3 times 10 to the 6. That's a very big K. This reaction lies far to the right when it's at equilibrium. And we've got SO3 as my product, right? We got way more product than we have the other, but the question is it enough? So let's plug in our numbers. SO3's concentration was handed to me on a silver platter. It's 10, and that's going to be squared. SO2's concentration is much smaller. It's 0.1, and that one is also squared. And O2's concentration was also 0.1, and that's going to give me, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 zeros. 1.0 times 10 to the fifth is going to be the value of QC in this case. That's a pretty big Q, but it's not big enough. Q is smaller. It's less than K. This is where it wants to be. How does it get bigger? It gets bigger by shifting towards the products, okay? So which way will this reaction proceed? It will proceed towards the products and form more SO3 using up some of the SO2 and the O2 along the way. All right, now, every example that we have done so far, everything's in the same state. They're either been gases. Actually, I think all my examples have been gases, but they could be aqueous as well. Those are called homogeneous equilibria, where everything is in the same state. What we're going to do next is see, well, what do we do if we've got things in different states? They're not all gases or aqueous.